Hi everybody, welcome to the vlog. Today I am going to talk about the world's godfather of soul himself, soul brother number one, the hardest working man in show business, the amazing Mr. Please Please himself, Mr. Dynamite, the sex machine himself, the minister of the all new super heavy funk, Butane James, the king of Super Dynamite Soul. Nobody had more nicknames than the inimitable James Brown himself. James Brown was one of the most influential and important figures in music history and is, for my money, possibly the most interesting person in the history of pop music. And as such, I couldn't possibly cover his entire story and legacy in one video, so it's going to take a few. But today, I'm going to start unraveling the incredible life and career of James Brown himself. I'm not really going to get into James Brown's personal life. Gets a little bit murky sometimes. He was a flawed man at times, and frankly, it's hard to piece together what is true and what is not about the larger-than-life figure that is James Brown, so we're going to stick to the career here. James Brown was born in 1933 in Carolina, and his family moved to Augusta, Georgia when he was about 4 or 5 years old. James Brown, from a very young age, despite being raised in poverty under very troubled circumstances, James Brown always showed an interest in performing. James Brown was entering talent shows when he was just a little kid and typically winning them. James Brown, just even as a little kid, could captivate an audience. And for my money, nobody captivated an audience better than James Brown. His career, unfortunately, was almost over before it began, as when he was 14, he was arrested on theft charges and brought to a juvenile detention facility. While he was in that detention facility, he met another singer by the name of Bobby Bird. Bobby Bird helped James Brown in his quest to find a work sponsor to get him out of this facility, and he did that. In 1952, James Brown was released on a 2-year work program, and by the time that was done, in 1954, James Brown joined Bobby Bird's group, which went through several names until eventually, by 1955, they settled on the Flames. James Brown began as the drummer in that group, I believe, and he moved on to be the singer slash pianist of that group by 1955. They played several nightclubs and bars in Georgia and sort of started to get a following in that little circuit there. Enough of a following to amend their name from the Flames to the Famous Flames. Now, the Famous Flames went through a lot of tumult and a lot of lineup changes over the 14 some odd years that they were together, and I'm not going to get into that because there's just so much. In 1955, James Brown went to see a Little Richard show. Little Richard had a massive hit at that time called Tutti Frutti, and which would just wind up being the first of many hits. I've already done a video on the life and times of Little Richard, but James Brown apparently was able to meet Little Richard backstage and said, "Hey, I'm James Brown from the touring group, the Famous Flames. I don't have a record deal. I don't know what the next step in my career should be. Can you help me out on this?" Now, Little Richard evidently liked him because he gave James the contact to his manager, which allowed James to talk to him and eventually secure a deal with King Records. But the contact to Little Richard's manager was not the only thing that James was able to take away from that encounter, as according to legend, he also found a little napkin in which Little Richard had written the words, "Please, please, please." James was fascinated by this and made it his mission to write a song around those words, and oh boy, did he ever.
Please, 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 please.
James, not only singing lead, but also playing piano on that track. Please, Please, Please became James Brown's first single for Federal, released in March of 1956. Federal, by the way, was just a subsidiary of the larger enterprise King Records. I, by the way, personally restored this early copy of Please, Please, Please on 78. I made a video about those restoration efforts as well. You can find the link to that video in the description as well. That song became a huge hit. It was a slow burner, not really selling a ton of copies overnight, but over the course of the first couple of years that it was out, Please, Please, Please sold over a million copies and was getting lots of radio play on black stations around that time. James released several follow-up singles, none of which really did particularly well at all. He was in dangerous one-hit wonder territory for a couple of years there, and by 1958, King Records was looking to drop James Brown. That was until, in the nick of time in 1958, James Brown put out the song Try Me.
Try me, try me.
Try Me became James Brown's first number one R&B hit, and it was the first of many. In the years to come, James Brown would release a ton of number one singles on the R&B charts for years and years and years. In the late 50s, this newfound success meant a couple of things. First of all, it meant that King Records, for the first time, put out an album of James Brown's material called Please, Please, Please. It also meant that James Brown could take an opportunity to overhaul his live show. He spent a lot of time working on the spectacle of what would become one of the greatest live shows on the planet, if not the greatest. Starting in the late 50s, James developed this new routine that he would do during his signature song, Please, 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 where he would play that song right at the end of the show, and he would just act totally exhausted and drop down to his knees dramatically, and he would be donned this cape, sort of reminiscent of a prize fighter, and sort of stagger off stage only to toss the cape aside and run back to the mic and keep going. And that he'd do that over and over, and it became his sort of signature trick that he would do until the end of his career. The guy with the cape there, by the way, that's Mr. Danny Ray. Danny Ray was James Brown's personal valet for nearly 50 years. And beginning in approximately 1959, he was the guy with the cape. That's what he kind of became known as well as being the MC for the James Brown show. He's most importantly the guy with the cape. A lot of people came and went from James Brown's career over the years, but Danny Ray was a constant fixture. Danny Ray continued to be James Brown's cape man until 2006. When James Brown died, he was always there. He still continued to be the MC for the original JB's group until at least 2018, and Danny Ray still lives on to this day. A fascinating figure in his own right. For somebody who was not a musician at all, I think he was very important to pop culture and showbiz history. The man with the cape, Danny Ray himself. Anyway, in the late 50s and early 60s, James Brown released hit after hit after hit on the R&B charts with songs like Bewildered, I Go Crazy, Think, I Don't Mind, Lost Someone, You've Got the Power, Mashed Potatoes USA, and released in 1962, Night Train. James Brown didn't write Night Train, it was already a standard, but it became a fixture of his live performances. And his live performances were gaining more and more notoriety and were just selling out everywhere he went. And he was doing better as a live performer than necessarily even as a studio artist, even though he released a number of hits. He also hadn't really broken out into the white crossover market yet. But he knew he had to somehow release some sort of record of his live show. And he tried to convince King Records to put out a live record. And they said, live records don't really sell. And that was true. The only people who sold copies of live records, particularly in those days, were the tops of the industry. And even then, live albums really weren't a big thing in 1962. James Brown said, "That's what I am. That's what people come to see, is the live show. It's what put me on the map. It's I need to have some sort of recording of this." And they continuously said no until James agreed to put up his own money to record one of his shows at the legendary Apollo Theater. On October 24th, he brought a team of recording engineers to the Apollo Theater, and they taped the concert. And in early 1963, Live at the Apollo was released. It was an absolute smash hit. They pressed a couple hundred thousand copies. They sold out. They printed a couple hundred thousand. They sold out too. King Records couldn't keep the thing on the shelves. It sold millions and millions of copies, propelled James Brown into superstardom, allowed for that white pop crossover market to suddenly appear for him, and now everyone was interested in this guy. Even just hearing his performance, you didn't have to see James Brown to know what his energy was all about. In 1963, he put out another big hit song, his cover of the song Prisoner of Love, and continued to tour, continued to perform. He began to be featured on television shows around this time. He was quickly becoming a household name. In fact, sometimes radio stations were so obsessed with James Brown that they would put on all of side one of the Live at the Apollo album, cut to commercial, come back, and play side two. Everyone was all about the James Brown, but he was not even at his peak yet. We're going to cover his peak in a future episode of this vlog. I've just covered the first 6 or 7 years of James Brown's massive 50-year career arc. Again, I am just all about the James Brown right now, mostly because there's so much to get into. If you haven't heard a lot of James Brown stuff, I highly recommend starting with the Star Time box set. It's a 5-CD box set, but it's all on Spotify now. And if you don't have the time to listen to that much, maybe listen to the Number Ones CD, which had a number of his number one R&B hits. James Brown, by the way, for all of his incredible success, never had a number one hit on the Billboard Hot 100 pop songs. Such a shame, but he had dozens of R&B number ones. Anyway, thank you so much for watching this episode of the vlog, this very special episode. For those of you who don't know, I'm a musician myself. Check out the description for links to where you can find my music, where it's sold or streamed online. Like this video if you like what you saw. Subscribe to this channel if you've been enjoying my videos. Ring the notification bell if you want to be notified whenever I upload a new video. Part 2 of the James Brown story will come real soon. Thanks so much for watching. Catch you again soon.